our practice, as you know, on Springwatch, is to rig this entire area with our mini cameras, and I can tell you that already we've got 40 miles of cabling out into these woods, down onto those marshes, and 38 mini cams out there. Michaela, these are just some of those that we've got cut up, and since you're new to the programme, you can pick our first live nest.
You're being so nice to me, Chris. You know what, I'm going to pick a bird that's familiar to most of us, and it is the blue tit. And one of the reasons I'm picking this is because it nested so early last year, but that by the time Springwatch came, they'd all fledged. Mm. This year, they've nested later, which means we can enjoy them. And there they are in the nest box, in a very cosy nest. But look at it, it's made out of sheep's wool.
It's wonderful, like a duvet.
It does look pretty comfortable, doesn't it? How many are in there? Well, we've got 10. We did actually think that it had gone down to 9, and then we noticed that a sibling was sitting on the 10th one. So 10 little birds in there, all very hungry, and the parents have been so busy.
They're fantastic. They're, what is it, about 500 visits per day the adults will bring food to them. It's incredibly hard work, isn't it? And they'll only have generally one brood, won't they, Chris?
Only have one brood, so if they get it wrong, the timing wrong, and they're not able to make those visits successful visits, i.e. bringing in food when they each time they come back, then obviously the numbers that were fledged will go down. But at the moment, in this fine weather, lack of rain, which washes the caterpillars off the trees and they become inaccessible to the blue tits, they're doing really, really well. It's nice to see.
Well, let's take a look at them, how they looked earlier, because obviously they looked a little pinker a few days ago. There's one of the adults. It has been amazing to watch, Martin, hasn't it? Because the parents are so attentive, and they've been coming in and out, 50 to 70 times an hour to feed their chicks.
Very interesting. They feed the chicks these caterpillars all the time, but they'll still come to the bird table occasionally for themselves, won't they, Chris, and have sort of seeds.
Which is why you should continue to feed them throughout the summer, because the adults will take that food to sustain them. They won't think of giving it to the chicks because they know they need protein, and basically that's animal food, that's insects.
What do you think their chances are then, Chris?
Well, I think at the moment it depends on the weather, really, but they're doing really, really well. It was very windy yesterday.
Very windy. You can see the feathers. Very, very windy, and so the parents were brooding them to keep them warm. Stop them getting too cold.
Although it was sunny this weekend, certainly where we've been, it was very windy.
Let's go next live to our nuthatches again for a better look at this nest, because it really is a real treat. They've grown a lot in the short time that we've been watching them over the weekend, and you can see the birds now have got their feathers in a pin. That means that they're wrapped in a waxy sheath, and they're beginning to preen them out. Now, if you look on the left-hand side of the screen there, you can see the smallest of our brood. There are 8 in there, but that's number 8, very definitely, which is smaller than all the rest, and we've been quite worried about that one, to be quite honest with you.
I didn't think he was going to make it over the weekend, Chris. But he's doing all right, isn't he?
But let's take a look at what they've been up to over the weekend, because they've been really, really busy here. Now, they're in a nest box. Typically, they would choose a natural hole, but they will go into nest boxes. I've had them in my garden. And here you can see the youngsters at a younger stage in their development. The adults are in and out all of the time, bringing in lots of caterpillars, which we think might be a clouded silver moth caterpillar. Our nest watchers have been diligently looking at those and tried to identify them.
But you know what, Chris? There were actually 8. Now it's down to 6. So we've got 6 with a runt. Could it go to 5 in the next few days? Let's hope not.
Well, there's a very interesting thing going on here, because our nest watchers think that there's only one parent here. This is a single-parent family. Can you tell the difference between male and female, Chris?
Well, yes, the females have slightly less chestnut on their body, but, of course, the top shot looking down on her there makes it almost impossible to tell.
But she's got her work cut out, really, to look after all of
those. Well, you say that, but, look, I've got some graphs.
It didn't take long.
I've got some graphs. These show the number of visits that bird has been making into the nest during the course of the day. So here we are. We start at 5 in the morning and we go through to 7 in the evening. And 27 times an hour is the peak here. On average, I suppose it's around 17. And there's a slight decline over the day. I should say that the red ones were for Sunday and the blue ones were for Saturday. But that bird, that individual bird, has come in 213 times on Saturday and 188 times on Sunday. So it's still very, very busy. The runt, however, has not been getting its fair share. This bar chart shows the amount that's typically going to the rest of the brood there, which is sort of 45 feeds, whereas the poor old runt's only getting 15, and then on Sunday, 30 feeds here, and the runt a few more, but obviously significantly less. Mm. But you know, I'm going to be controversial.
Go on, Chris.
Go on.
Surprise, surprise.
You see, that's unlike you.
We have seen that single bird going in and out of the nest, so we are presuming, therefore, that it's a single parent. But what about if it's going out of the nest and collecting food from the other bird, the male? Sometimes she goes out so quickly and comes back after in an instant with a mouthful of caterpillars. I can't believe that she finds them that quickly. I think she's going out, getting them from the male, and then taking them in to feed them, and that does happen sometimes. My task, therefore, is to send one of our wildlife cameramen out tomorrow to the nuthatch site to see if they can record that.
Gosh. But, Chris, you know you were saying the run...
Just a theory.
The run is not getting as much food, but every so often it gets lucky. Take a look at this. Now, there they all are. Mum comes in with a caterpillar, stuffs it down. Oh, no, did you see that? You might have missed it. I'm going to show it again, because, look, it's actually brilliant. Comes in, tries to put it in one mouth, takes it out again, and watch, because it jumps and flies into Runty's mouth.
How lucky was that? That's a good square meal. A quick question has come straight in. Christine Duffett on Facebook, what will happen when the nuthatches begin to fledge if the runt is left behind? Will the mother continue to feed Wee Baldy, or will she be distracted by the fledglings outside the nest?
Well, it does become more difficult for a nuthatch adult to feed the brood once they leave the nest, because as soon as they come out, they're remarkably antisocial. And rather than huddle together like some birds will, they immediately split up and won't tolerate being too close to one another, which means that the adults have to make separate visits to all of the chicks. So I guess if one's left in the box, it will be at a disadvantage. But we'll have to see how things progress over the next couple of days in terms of that runt making it, if he does at all. Now-